So today I want to talk about something that's extremely important. We all know it, but without this, you don't have sechal. And the word sechal means understanding, it means discernment, it means putting two and two together, it means being having good success, being prosperous, it means literally being able to see something and to understand what it's about and to do something prudent about it, to have wisdom. So how do you get this sechal? How do you get this understanding and provision? And then many people say, do you know the Lord? Do you know the Lord? Do you know the Lord? Do you have a relationship with the Lord? And many people make it sound like you get this relationship through being special, or there's some secret to having this knowing the Lord. But the things of God are simple. And the things of God are easy to understand. And God doesn't want the great saint to know Him more than the little saint. The Bible says we can all know Him. Say all. From the littlest saint to the greatest saint, we can all know Him. Hallelujah. So today I want to talk about where will the Lord meet and speak with us. Where will the Lord meet and speak with us? So when you approach God, how do you think God speaks to you? How do you think God is going to speak to you? And where do you think God is going to speak to you from? Is your picture of God speaking to you an angry God? If you do something wrong, He's upset, He's got a frown on His face, He's upset with you. And do you think that God comes to you from a place of judgment or from a place of anger? So today we're going to talk about how to have the right understanding of God and where does God speak to us and meet with us from. Because God says in His Word, there, say there, there I'll meet with you and there I'll speak with you. So if you're hearing God speak from somewhere else, then it's not God. Isn't that easy to understand then? If God's speaking to you from somewhere else other than this place, then it's not God. Because God says, there I will meet with you and there I will speak to you. So if you're there, then you know God is speaking to you. If you're there, then you know you're meeting with God. Hallelujah. So last week, we talked about last week was the Afrikaans service. We're going to mention it quickly. But the week before that, we talked about sleeping. And what is sleeping in the Bible? So we've got the body, soul, and spirit. I'm not going to ask Cara, Mika, and Kayla to come stand up here again. But in the body, if you're sleeping, what does that mean? You're either sleeping like Jesus slept in the boat, you're physically sleeping, or you're sleeping in the sense that you are dead. So when a Christian dies, the Bible says they are sleeping physically. Okay. And then if you're sleeping in the soul, in your mind, emotions, in your consciousness, then you are not forgiveness conscious. You don't know that you are forgiven of your entire life sins, or you are sluggish and you are, in a sense, you are sleeping to the sense that I'm forgiven of all my sins. You're in the dark. You have forgotten it. Or you're not continually walking in that consciousness that you are forgiven of your entire life sins. And how will you see that in believers? It'll be hard for you to forgive others. You'll speak harshly to people. You'll get easily irritated with everyone. You're going to think they have a problem and not you. But and then if you are sleeping in the spirit, you are not born again. You are not saved. But as a believer, when you're born again, you always have a reason to be happy. You always have a reason to be excited. Why? Because you are forgiven. When you're forgiven, you have a reason to be happy. When you're born again, you can always be happy. In Romans 4, verse 7 to 8, Paul quotes David from Psalm 32, verse 1 and 2. And Psalm 32 is a maskil. And maskil is the Hebrew word that comes from sechal. So like I started off, I said sechal. And what was sechal? Understanding, wisdom, being prosperous, having good success. Now, how does David say, do you become a prosperous man? How does David say, do you get good success? He says, blessed and happy and to be envied are those whose iniquities are forgiven, and those whose sins are covered up and completely buried. Blessed and happy and to be envied is the person of whose sin the Lord will take no account nor reckon it against him. You are justified, just as if you never sinned. Now that word covered up is something we're going to be taking a look at. It's not the exact word, but it has the picture connected to it. When the Bible talks about covering the sin, it's referring to the mercy seat. Say mercy seat. Now the mercy seat is a symbol of Christ. Christ is our mercy seat. Kaporet. Kaporet is the mercy seat. Now say with me. Say, I am blessed and happy and to be envied. My iniquities are forgiven and my sins are covered up and completely buried. I am blessed and happy and to be envied. My sin the Lord will take no account nor reckon it against me. Amen. So you can be happy always. You're always happy. You always have a smile on your face. You're always excited. You are blessed no matter what. And then what's going to happen? If you're so blessed and you're not stressed, then others are going to look at you and say, why are you so happy? Why are you so excited for all time? Why are you blessed? Then that's your opportunity to tell them, are you born again? Are you saved? Because the reason why I'm happy is because I'm born again. I'm saved. So I want to quickly go with you guys through how to lead someone to the Lord. Because in the times we're living in, when you get the opportunity, you should give the hope that's in you. You must tell people why you're so hopeful. And you ask them just, are you born again? Are you saved? And then you can tell them why they need to be saved. And what is salvation and why it is important. So in a word, salvation means being saved from separation from God. So you tell them, we've all been separated from God through Adam's sin. And the reason why we separated was because of sin. But God loved us so much that He sent us, Jesus, to die on the cross for us. And by His blood, He's removed that separation of sin. But in His mercy, God wanted us to spend eternity in heaven and loved us so much that He sent His only Son, Jesus, to end that separation and legally restore our relationship with Him like it was before Adam sinned, and even better because God's restoration is always much greater. And like we said, what's spiritual death? Spiritual death is separation from God. That's spiritual death. Separation from God. And this restored relationship with God is a free gift. Now, would you like to pray the following prayer with me and receive this gift of reconciliation with God and eternal life? And what is eternal life? Having an intimate relationship with God, our Father, and with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Because even some Christians don't know what eternal life is. Eternal life is a relationship with Jesus and with Daddy God. And then they'll say yes. If they don't say yes, then don't force it on them. You cool. You never have to defend your truth. Hallelujah. But then you say, let's pray this together. And you say, dear God, I come to you in the name of your Son Jesus. And they pray it with you. And you say, I realize why I need salvation. I ask you to forgive me of my sin that was inherited from Adam. You said that the wages of sin is death, eternal death and separation from you. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And you said, if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and if I acknowledge that He died to restore my relationship with you while believing in my heart that you raised Jesus from the dead, I will be saved. Right now, I confess out loud that Jesus is Lord, and I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead for me. Thank you for saving me. I believe these things are true, and you hear my prayer. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So it's easy to remember. It's ABC. They must admit that they are a sinner. And why are they a sinner? Because of Adam's sin. That's what caused the separation. Then you must believe in Jesus Christ, that he died for your sin and he was raised again so that you can be justified, just as if you never sinned. And then you call upon his name. You say, thank you, Lord, that you are my Lord, Jesus. Hallelujah. And if you confess that Jesus is Lord, then what happens? You are saved. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, when they've prayed that prayer, you ask them to speak it or say it to someone else. Because why? Faith has actions. So that you can prove to yourself, that you acknowledge to yourself that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then you encourage them to go to a local church. Because the Bible says we must gather together. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And then, if they're close to you or they're close to Ingunubi, you can encourage them to come to Father Hartkerk. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So last week, we took a look at Zechariah. And why is Zechariah important? You can show them the picture, please. Now, Zechariah is important. Zechariah is important. Why? Because it's referring to the church. Now, here is the lampstand, the menorah. The menorah is the church, and it's the local church. The lamps represent the local church. The entire lampstand represents the church, and in the midst is Jesus. The lamps on fire also represent us, the individuals in the local church. And what is the light? The fire. The fire, the light is that we're born again, that we're forgiven of all our sins. And the light that you shine is forgiveness, is love. Because what's love? Love gives and love forgives. Good. Hallelujah. So the light that you shine is love. Say light. Light. Love. Light shines love. Now, what are these trees? These trees are olive trees. Say olive trees. Now, these olive trees, one on the right, one on the left, represents Moses and Elijah. Okay? Why do I say that? Because that's what the Bible says. The Bible says that the two trees are men. And the men, you can see in Revelation 11. The one tree turns water into blood. The other one causes droughts, that it doesn't rain. Which two prophets did that in the Bible? Moses turned water into blood. Elijah stopped it to rain, prayed, and it didn't rain. Also, when this scenario here is a picture of, is a manifestation of Matthew 17. Because in Matthew 17, the Bible says Jesus stood in the middle, and then Moses and Elijah appeared, one on his right and one on his left. So this is a picture of Matthew 17 where Moses and Elijah appears. Now, what does Moses represent as well? Moses represents the first five books of the Bible. He represents the Torah. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, and Psalm 90. Now, what pours out of Moses? The oil, the life. And what does the Bible say? The word of Christ is spirit and it is life. So out of Moses, out of the books of the Bible, comes the oil. You see the oil? There's a pipe. You guys see the pipe? From the pipe, there's oil pouring into this bowl. And from Elijah, the prophets and the scriptures, you can see the oil because Elijah represents the prophets. And from the prophets, like Isaiah, 1st and 2nd Samuel, the Psalms, there is oil coming out because the word is spirit and it is life. And the spirit is represented by oil, olive oil. You see the olive oil? Now, what does the bowl represent? The bowl represents the abundance of grace. And where is this bowl? It's in your spirit. Because Jesus said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. And this bowl can be translated as rivers of living water. So now, this picture here is two sides to it. First side is, this bowl represents your spirit. The bowl in your spirit. Now, what does that mean? When you receive the oil, it's not just for yourself. The oil is for the church and for the people in your life. It needs to flow out of you to the people around you. Because otherwise, if that oil just stays in your bowl, it's going to fruit. It's going to get rotten. It needs to flow because oil, the rivers flow. It's not dams, it's rivers. Because a dam, if it doesn't eventually get rid of the water, it's going to get rotten. It needs to flow. So this bowl needs to flow to the churches. And then the same way, the other picture is, it represents the church, the sermon on Sunday, or the words in the Bible feeding you. Because this is also you. You see, so you come on Sunday, you come to church to receive the oil of God, the words of spirit and life to you, so that you can shine brightly and burn brightly. So in Luke 24, Jesus said, when he was talking with the two disciples that were sad and depressed, what did he say to them? He started expounding to them in the scriptures all the things concerning himself. And what does he say? He expounded to him the things concerning himself in the books of Moses and the prophets. So the books of Moses and the prophets. And then what happened? He expounded to them, so he got the oil out of Moses and the prophets, and it flowed to the two disciples. And what did they say? Our hearts burned within us. So their lights shone because of the expounding in the scriptures. So that's what you do on Sunday. You come to church to hear how Jesus gets expounded in the scriptures. You reveal Jesus in the books of Moses and the prophets in the Old Testament. Hallelujah. And then the light in you flames up. Your heart starts to burn. Hallelujah. You guys following a bit? Now, what does the oil represent? Spirit, Holy Spirit. What do the pipes represent? Faith and hope. So because how do you receive the word spoken? You have to believe it. Otherwise, this pipe is not going to be, because if the oil just stays there and it doesn't flow to you, you're not going to receive it. So you need to believe it. Then it flows to you. That's the pipe. And then hope opens up the pipe. The expectation of what you believe. You believe that God favors you, and then belief says it. I am highly favored. But then hope expects it. I expect to be highly favored. So what does worry do? Worry, you can't have hope and faith and worry at the same time. Worry not makes hope null and void. So worry closes the pipes. Fear closes the pipes. But what do? You come to church and you say, thank you, Lord, I believe your word. And I expect what your word says when you open up the pipe. You guys following? The word worry means to close. So when you're worried, you close those pipes. But when you let go and you trust God, you open up the pipes. Hallelujah. So let's read in Luke 24, verse 50. It says, now it came to pass as he sat at the table with them. And that's what we're going to do now. We're sitting at the table. That Jesus took bread. So you can take your bread. Jesus took bread. He blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Now what happens when you eat Jesus' body? Verse 31. Then their eyes were opened and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. So when you partake of Jesus, when you partake of a communion, Your eyes are opened. Because why? You receive wisdom. And the blood, you receive the forgiveness of sins because you are forgiven of all your sins. Hallelujah. Like we saw, when you're forgiven of all your sins, you have that wisdom. So lift up the bread. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that by your stripes we are forgiven of all, we are healed, and your body took every sin upon your body. Thank you, Lord, that we are forgiven and we are healed by your stripes. In Jesus' name, amen. And hold up the cup. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the cup of the new covenant. A better covenant established on better promises. Thank you that we are forgiven of all our sins. And we are the righteousness of God in Christ, just as if we never sinned. And we are always right with Daddy God because of your blood. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The communion, the bread, is the bread of life, Jesus said. And the cup is the fountain of youth. So when the more you partake of Jesus, the younger you are, the stronger you are. Hallelujah. So in verse 32 of Luke 24, it says, "And they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us?" Now, when did this happen? On the first Sunday of Jesus' resurrection. So the day Jesus was resurrected, what did Jesus do? He expounded in the Word of God the things concerning himself. And then what happened? Their hearts burnt. So that's the picture of Zechariah 4. As you expound Moses and the prophets, that oil flows into you and your heart burns. Hallelujah. But then what happened? They walked 14 kilometers to their home. When they partook of the communion and when they heard the word, it revived them. It gave them energy and strength. Then they walked back to Jerusalem. So they were energized because the word of God brings life to all your flesh. So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And they told about the things that had happened on the road and how Jesus was known to them in the breaking of bread. Hallelujah. So let's do that a little bit tonight. Let's expound some of the things concerning Jesus in the book of Moses. So we're going to look at Exodus 25 today. Okay, Exodus 25 verse 10 to 22. So I'll show you guys the videos another time. But I was going to show you the Ark of the Covenant. And in the Ark of the Covenant, it shows us that Jesus is the mercy seat. Jesus is the mercy seat and Jesus is the Ark. You can show them just maybe the picture of the Ark of the Covenant. I had a guy do this whole video, but I forgot it at home. Anyway, so this ark, the mercy seat, and the ark represents Jesus in his entirety. The ark is made out of wood, and this wood is acacia wood. Now, what does the wood represent? The wood represents Jesus' humanity, that Jesus is 100% man. But this wood, acacia wood, is incorruptible wood. So it represents Jesus as the perfect man. Then you have the gold overlaying the wood. And what does the gold represent? This is pure gold. And gold represents incorruptibility also. And what is incorruptible? The Word of God. 1 Peter 1 says, the Word of God, the seed of the Word of God is incorruptible. So it represents Jesus' divinity and Jesus' deity. That Jesus is the incorruptible Word of God. That's the Ark of the Covenant. But then the Bible says, put in the ark the tablets, the testimony. And what's the tablets? What's the testimony? The law. So put in the ark the law. And what does the law represent? It represents man's rebellion against God's perfect standard, because no one can keep the law. Then you have the manna put in the ark. What does the manna represent? That man's rebellion against God's provision. Because they said, we hate this manna. And then you put in the ark Aaron's rod. And what does Aaron's rod represent? Man's rebellion against God's appointed leadership. So you put in the ark man's rebellion, man's iniquities, man's sins. And then you cover it with the mercy seat. Say mercy seat. So, kaporet. Now, the mercy seat means a covering. It means covering the sin. Now, this mercy seat has the cherubim of his angels sitting there. Also, if you take a look, when Jesus rose from the dead, what happened where Jesus laid? Two angels sat where Jesus laid, representing the mercy seat. Now, the Bible says, since I forgot the videos, we're actually saving you a lot of time, so maybe it's good for you guys, and you're not going to feel tired, because those were long, not long videos, but they were okay. But anyway, in Romans 3 verse 25, it says that Jesus is the mercy seat, and the mercy seat is by Jesus' blood. Then in Exodus 25 verse 21, it says, you shall put the mercy seat on top of the ark, and in the ark you shall put the testimony that I will give you. And there, say there I will meet with you, and I will speak with you from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim, which are on the ark of the testimony, about everything which I will give you in commandment to the children of Israel. So where does God speak to us from? From above the mercy seat. He doesn't speak to you from the law. He doesn't speak to you from anger or from your rebellion, from your mistakes, what you've done wrong. He speaks to you from mercy. He speaks to you from between the wings of the cherubim. He speaks to you from Psalm 91 verse 1, in the secret place of the Most High, under the shadows of the Almighty. Hallelujah. So God speaks to you only from a point of mercy, from the secret place. He speaks to you from mercy, from grace. So what does that mean? The Bible says we can also then speak to other people from mercy. Because like it says, what upsets the Holy Spirit? Most people say that hurts the Holy Spirit. What hurts the Holy Spirit? When you speak continually to others just what they deserve. If people deserve evil, oh, you speak evil to them. No, God doesn't speak to us like that. We can speak to other people from forgiveness. Hallelujah. Because God only speaks to us from love and from forgiveness. God only speaks well. He doesn't speak evil towards us. So then I have lots and lots of verses. I don't know if I'm going to read all of these verses to you guys, but Hebrews 8 verse 6 tells us that Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant, established on better promises. And it's not just a better covenant, it's a new covenant. Say new covenant. So it's a new covenant, it's a better covenant, and it's established on better promises. And then it says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. Because finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. And then he talks about this new covenant. But then what is the crux of the new covenant? And why is this new covenant important? Let's skip to verse 10. It says, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind and write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Then it says in verse 10, none of them shall teach his neighbor and none his brother, saying, know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. So like we can say, said, everyone can know the Lord. From the least to the greatest. Now, why can you know the Lord? And like we said in the beginning, how or why can you be prosperous? How can you be successful and have good success? Because I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and their lawless deeds, I will remember no more. Praise the Lord. You guys can go read the rest of Hebrews 8, verse 13. And then Hebrews 9 talks about this Ark of the Covenant. It talks about, firstly, all the other elements and things in the tabernacle. I had a video for that also, but I can't believe I forgot it. But then, this Ark of the Covenant overlaid on all sides with gold. That's verse 4. Why? It speaks about the incorruptible seed of the Word of God, that Jesus is the incorruptible seed. And in it, like we said, you've got the golden pot of manna, Aaron's rod, and the tablets of the covenant representing man's rebellion. And above it was the mercy seat, verse 5. And like we already said, what does this represent? It represents the forgiveness. Jesus is the mercy seat. But why is it important to know that Jesus has done a better work than the symbolism of just sprinkling blood of bulls and goats? Because in verse 9 it says, it was symbolic for the present time in which both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to the conscience. Say conscience. So when you speak to God, and when you know God speaks to you, you can know that God always speaks to you in love. He always speaks to you in peace, in kindness, in patience. You can go read 1 Corinthians 13, the fruit of the love. He's never easily angered. He's never angry with you. Because then your conscience is the thing that condemns you. Because when you do something wrong, you think, no, God condemns me. No, it's your conscience condemning you. It's your conscience convicting you. And what does the conscience say? You did something wrong, so there needs to be a punishment. Hey? If you make a mistake, oh, there needs to be a punishment. But what can you say? Jesus took the punishment. So my conscience can be, say, conscience, Jesus took it. In verse 11 it says, but Christ came as high priest of the good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation. Verse 12, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all. Say once for all. Having obtained eternal redemption. Say eternal. So, we are eternally saved. We are eternally forgiven. We are eternally justified. Eternally made righteous. And having, not he will obtain, having obtained. Then verse 14 says, how much more? So, in comparison, if the bulls and goats and the rams and the heifer blood could cleanse or cover the sins, how much more, verse 14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience. Cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. So why is it important to have a conscience that's clear, a cleared conscience? Because many diseases and many problems and many fights and many issues happen because your conscience is guilty. Your conscience feels condemned. Your conscience feels convicted. So like, let's say you made a mistake with something, and then, or you made a mistake at your job, and then the husband goes home and he feels like, oh, I messed up. And then his wife starts talking to him about the job, and he's irritable, and he's short, and he gets easily angered. What happens? His conscience feels guilty, so that's why he's acting like that. As soon as you feel condemned for something, then you are more irritable. You're more easily angered. But what can we say? Conscience, you are cleansed. You are cleansed by the blood of Jesus. I can speak to people from mercy. From mercy, above the mercy seat. Because my conscience is cleared. Say, I have a clear conscience. So a Christian must never have feelings of guilt or feelings of shame. We must always have a cleansed conscience. Hallelujah. And this conscience is cleansed so that we no longer have dead works. You guys see verse 14? Take a look. So that we are cleansed, so that we don't have dead works. You don't have dead works so that you can have living works to serve the living God. What's a dead work? So, let's say your conscience is guilty. You're going to try and do things to get your conscience better. So that you no longer feel guilty. That's a dead work. If you're doing something motivated so that you can feel better and make your conscience feel better, that's a dead work. Everything must be motivated from forgiveness. Everything must be motivated from knowing that you are loved and accepted and forgiven. The same way when you give your tithes and give your offerings. If you're giving your tithes and offerings so that God's not going to curse you from the book of Malachi chapter 3, or so that, oh, you know, I have to do it, then what happens? It profits you nothing. You must tithe and offer and do things because you love doing it. You love giving. The Bible says, if you do stuff motivated by love, it profits you. But if you do stuff not motivated by love, it profits you nothing. So what is love? Love gives. So you do it because you love to give. And why do you love to give? Why do you love to forgive? Because you know you are forgiven and you know you are loved. Hallelujah. Are you guys following? So you are not doing anything to be forgiven or justified or made righteous. You are forgiven and justified and declared righteous forever. So now works can be living works, serving the living God, because you are motivated by love. Hallelujah. And then verse 15 tells us that we have an eternal inheritance. Hallelujah. And a promise of eternal inheritance. Say, I have an eternal inheritance. Where is this inheritance? You can see your inheritance in the Word of God. You can take a look at your inheritance in the Word of God. Hallelujah. Because what was the Israelis or the Jewish people's inheritance? The land. The land was their inheritance. And what's our land? The Word of God. So you can open the Word of God and take a look at your inheritance. Hallelujah. And say, this is my inheritance. So if the Word of God says, as Jesus is, so am I in this world, amen, that's my inheritance. If the Word of God says, I'm forgiven of all my sins, I'm healed of all my diseases, I'm delivered from the pit, my youth is renewed like the eagles, you say, that's my inheritance, and it's a eternal inheritance. And to whom is this given? To the called. Say, I'm called. I'm called. I'm called. Are you guys not hearing my accent too deep? I am called. Called. Comiso. Hey? You guys don't hear what I'm saying. I am C-A-L-L-E-D. Called. Okay, so let's sum it up with Isaiah 54 verse 9. God says, for this is like the waters of Noah to me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah would no longer cover the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be angry with you, nor rebuke you. So God has sworn that when He speaks to you, He doesn't speak to you from anger. Not even from rebuke. Verse 10. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my chesed, my grace, my kindness, my unmerited favor shall not depart from you, nor shall my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has mercy on you. So God only speaks to us from the gospel of grace, mercy, and peace. Shalom. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Show him the mercy seat again. So God says, there I will meet and speak with you. Next. There I will meet and speak with you from mercy. From mercy. God speaks patiently. God speaks kindly. God speaks gently. God speaks friendly. God speaks compassionately. God speaks well and not evil. Hallelujah. God speaks well towards you. And He speaks lovingly. So therefore, you can speak to others. You can speak to your family, your friends, your wife, your spouse. You can speak the same way. Because what? We are the lights on the menorah. And what do we shine? Forgiveness. We shine reconciliation. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You guys can receive the blessing. Yivarechecha Yahweh v'yishmarecha. Ya'er Yahweh penav ilecha v'chuneka. Yisa Yahweh penav ilecha v'yasem lecha shalom. Thank you, Abba, that when you speak to us, you speak from mercy. You give us mercy in abundance. Thank you, Lord, for your abundant grace, chesed, and mercy and kindness toward us. Thank you, Lord, for your shalom, that we are in a covenant of shalom, and you give us shalom in every area of our lives. And thank you, Lord, that we are in a covenant of grace, of chesed. Thank you, Lord, for your abundant chesed, and we depend on your grace. We depend on your chesed this week. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. And thank you for your protection. In Jesus' name, amen.